Good morning, everyone. It is 3 weeks until Easter. So praise the Lord. I think even someone this morning said, he is risen. And of course we had to say, I think it was Pastor Phil, he is risen indeed. Every day he's risen, amen? Let's stand as we worship. Lord of all creation, water, earth, and sky. Heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are this day, Lord, in this place. We love you, Lord Jesus. We pray all these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And all God's people say, amen. It's so good to be here with you guys. Before you're seated, let's find someone you haven't met before.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to second service. I don't know how many of you tried to go to first service today. No? Everybody's on time. Way to go. Good job. Well, if you are new or visiting, or just glad to have you, I want to give you a round of applause. Just thank you for coming, being with us. We don't really know what else to do besides to welcome you that way. We're just blessed to have you here and to pray you feel the love of the Lord today. There are an info sheets in your bulletin. For those who are new or visiting, we'd love for you to fill those out and just let us get to know you. And also for anybody else, if you have any prayer requests, anything that's on your heart you need, like to have prayer for, we have a prayer chain that goes out on email, and also we pray here on the services. And you can fill it out and then drop it off in the two tithes and offerings boxes right in the back of the sanctuary. That would be great. Very brief announcements again today. And the first announcement is about Easter. Easter is coming up real fast and pretty exciting. And we have lots going on for Easter. We get to celebrate our Lord, death, in the tomb, risen again. And as we say, he is risen. He is risen indeed. The Bible says that if the dead are not risen, if Christ does not rise, our faith is in vain. But the cool thing is he did rise from the dead. And because of that, our sins are forgiven. We're going to heaven. Awesome. So we get to celebrate that. We're going to have a Palm Sunday service on Palm Sunday. And then on Friday following, a Good Friday service with Tenebrae called the Darkening. We'll be right here. It's a special just a reflective service on the Lord died for us. Veritas Christian Fellowship on Saturday. And then I think it's my favorite. It's a sunrise service on Sunday morning. We have to go to Bradley Lake Park. And it's just cool to see the ocean. The lake. The ocean would be nice too. The lake, just have the steam coming off the lake. And sometimes it's raining, but hopefully it won't. And one year we saw an eagle, and that was just really cool. So just to do the same thing as the ladies came early to the tomb, we want to remember that, come early in the morning. And then the two services here on Sunday. And just following that, the next announcement is about baptism. And Christ, as he died and rose again, he established his church. And he told his followers to be baptized. And so we just want to encourage people, if you haven't been baptized, to sign up. There's an info sheet out there on the information table. You can sign up there. We'd love to see you get baptized, make that public profession of your faith in Christ. And so that's there for you. And the last announcement is about the women's breakfast. Ladies, we had a great men's breakfast yesterday, and the ladies' breakfast is coming up this Saturday at 9 a.m. right here. And it's just always good for ladies to get together, men to get together, to have fellowship. And that is there for you, 9 a.m. Love to have you come out. And just to wrap up, if you have cell phones, which you're probably thankful for because they woke you up this morning, silence those. And there's a couple of rows in the back that you can seat yourself if you need to leave the sanctuary, not to, to limit distractions. And lastly, I told the first service as well, we want to be nice Christians, and if anybody comes in late, an hour late, no pointing at them, and you can't laugh, and it's all right. So, okay, let's pray. Thank you, Lord, that we're here today. Thank you that your mercies are new every morning. Thank you that you love us and care about us. Lord, we pray that you would be honored today. We would honor you with our voices and singing. That we'd honor you as we hear from your word about the shipwreck of Paul and those who were with him. We pray you'd teach us from it. You'd teach us about trusting in you, following you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thou changest not thy countenance.
just our voice.
You are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy Lord. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Amen.
Lord Jesus, you are the worthy lamb who was slain for the sins of the world. Oh Lord, every time we sing that song, we're reminded of the day when we will bow before you, declaring, worthy is the Lamb who was slain for our sins. Lord, we ask that this morning as we gather together that you would, by the Holy Spirit, give us a greater sense of this truth than we've ever had before. We thank you for this morning. We thank you, Lord God, that we can bring things to you that are on our hearts, Lord. We pray that your loving arms would be around those who are pressing through difficulties as we learn in our text this morning how to press through the storms in this life. We ask that you would comfort and encourage those who are missing loved ones, who are serving in our military faithfully, defending our country, deployed overseas to many areas, especially those who are serving in harm's way, Lord God. We ask that your hand would be upon them and comfort families who are missing them. Bring them home safely to us, we ask, oh Lord. In Jesus' name, we ask that. We pray for our missionaries, Lord God. We ask that you'd be with them, that you would encourage them as they're seeking your will and your purpose and your plan for the ministries that you've called them to. We pray for those who are serving, Lord, in violent areas in Mexico, Central America. We ask that you'd be with the Vargases in Bishinova, the Sancheses with the orphanage in Bishinova. We pray that you'd be with the Myers in Belize. We ask, Lord God, that you would especially be with Luis as he's fighting this cold, Lord God. He has been for a while. Would you just give him good health? Wrap your loving arms around the Ibbotsons in Austria, the Ibbotsons in Germany as well, Lord God. Be with the Spectres in Croatia, and the Boulets in Germany, Lord. Thank you that we have the opportunity to pray for these dear brothers and sisters, O Lord, serving. Thank you that they can be an extension of us, O Lord. We just pray, Lord God, for those who are seeking employment, especially we lift up Christina Murillo as she's just asking for prayer for this social worker's position at St. Joe's, Lord God. If it's of you, Lord, would you give it to her, we ask. We know that you desire to give good and perfect gifts to those who ask in your name. We ask that in your name. We praise you, Lord God, for healings that are taking place, and we continue to pray with great confidence for Deanna and Bill, Caleb, Melissa, Tanya. We ask that your hand would be upon them. We ask that you would bring healing to their bodies, oh Lord. Help them to trust you. If they're growing weary, help them to cling to you, to hold fast to you, oh Lord. We pray for families that are going through difficult times, oh Lord, for any number of reasons, Lord God. We ask that your hand would be upon them, Lord God. We just ask, Lord God, that you would just minister to every need represented here. We pray that you'd be with these dear sisters who are with child, that you'd give them full-term pregnancies and healthy deliveries. Be with those who are seeking to adopt, oh Lord. We ask that your hand would be upon them and encourage them. Those who are waiting patiently to have children of their own, Lord God, just give them strength of heart, we ask, in Jesus' name. We pray for our president and his administration. Pray for his upcoming trip to the Middle East. Our prayer, Lord God, would be that you would move upon his heart to solidify our relationship with Israel, Lord God. As a nation, we want to pray. As a church, we want to pray for peace in Israel. And we want to pray for Israel as your word commands us to do, O Lord. We're going to pray, Lord God, for our children's ministry. Thank you, Lord, for just the good report we heard from the children's ministry retreat. We're so grateful for just bringing them back safely. Just continue, Lord. Thank you for the out of the mouth of one of the children to just telling me that they learned to the power. God is powerful over sin. Protect them, Lord God, from their own foolishness, that they might delight in you, O Lord. For all of sin falls short of the glory of God. We stand before you. Not one of us here has triumphed over sin. It's you that triumphs in us, O God. May we always give you the glory for that. Pray that you'd be with our children's ministers as they minister to them today's service in our junior high ministry. Thank you for all that's taking place there. And just minister through the team there. Speak through Pastor Jason as he teaches our Abide Junior High. And Lord, as we come before you this morning, continuing in an attitude of praise and worship, we give you thanks for the facility that you've been so gracious in providing for us. We thank you for the relationship that we have with the school administration. Lord God, there isn't a week that goes by that my heart isn't just overjoyed at your goodness to provide this place for us. We thank you for the resources that you provide, the finances that you provide, and we ask that you would just put upon our hearts, Lord God, how it is that you would have us give. We want to be cheerful givers. We want to be generous givers, not out of a compulsion, but out of just worshiping you for who you are, O Lord. We acknowledge that all things come from you. We do not take that lightly, O Lord. And it is with an attitude of humility that we come before you. We offer you these gifts. Give the leadership wisdom that we might invest these resources for the furthering of your kingdom. We want to do so much, Lord. There's so much more that needs to be done. Help us to grow in an understanding of what that looks like. There's nothing too hard for you. We acknowledge that before you and before one another this morning. In Jesus' name, we pray.
All to Jesus I surrender. simplest of all love songs, I want to bring to you. So I let my words be few. Jesus,
Lord, it's good to stand before you. And as we do stand in awe with very few words that can be spoken because of our love for you. Lord, we know that there are times in the course of our weeks, even this morning, where we've not represented our love for you. We ask your forgiveness. We ask that you would just receive our praise, our worship, and our adoration. And that in our action of standing before you, that you would accept our desire to walk in your ways, in your truth. We love you, Lord. We thank you for your mercy and your love and your grace towards us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning to you all. It is good to see you once again. Doesn't it just seem like the weeks fly by? I mean, seems like we were just here a week ago. Because we were here a week ago. Let's open our Bibles to Acts chapter 27. Acts chapter 27. If you need a Bible, will you raise your hand nice and high so one of the ushers can be sure to get one to you? You're going to always want to have a Bible with you, because we're going to look at a bunch of different verses here, and this morning's message is an exciting one. How many of you just love the thought of being on a ship that's about to sink? How many of you feel like you're on a ship right now that's about to sink? There may be a few of you that are feeling that way. Well, just as a little point of refresher from last week, as we finished up chapter 26, we left off with Paul in Caesarea, if you remember, giving his defense before Festus, the governor of Judea, and before King Agrippa, along with a whole host of dignitaries. And we learned that it really was more of an opportunity for Paul to preach the gospel to Agrippa than it was for him to defend himself. If you remember, at the end of all that Paul had to say, Festus, the governor of Judea, he gets all worked up and he accuses Paul of just being crazy. He accuses him and he says, you know, all this learning that you've been doing, Paul, it's made you nuts. But Agrippa, we know that that wasn't the case. Agrippa was not so quick to call Paul a madman, but rather to declare to Paul, Paul, you almost persuade me to be a Christian. And if you remember afterwards, Paul acknowledges his desire before God that not only Agrippa, but that everyone who heard what he had to say might become a Christian. Because Paul's desire for people to get saved was insatiable. It could not be satisfied. It's how he lived his life. And I believe it's how the Lord would have us live our lives as well. That we would pray, oh Lord, would you just give us an insatiable appetite to be able to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ to others. Agrippa concludes by declaring Paul to be innocent. He said this man might have been set free had he not appealed to Caesar. But we know that Paul wasn't really all that concerned about being set free because he longed to go to Rome. And rather than seeing this as a poor me, me being falsely accused, he embraces it as an opportunity to preach the gospel, to preach it in Rome before the most powerful man in the world, Caesar himself. And so beginning here in chapter 27, verse 1, the journey to Rome begins. Can we stand together and read chapter 27? When it was decided that we should sail to Italy, they delivered Paul and some other prisoners to the one named Julius, a centurion of the Augustan regiment. So entering a ship of Adramyttium, we put to sea, meaning to sail along the coasts of Asia. Aristarchus, a Macedonian of Thessalonica, was with us. And the next day we landed at Sidon, and Julius treated Paul kindly and gave him liberty to go to his friends and receive care. When we had put to sea from there, we sailed under the shelter of Cyprus because the winds were contrary. And when we had sailed over the sea, which is off Cilicia and Pamphylia, we came to Myra, a city of Lycia. There the centurion found an Alexandrian ship sailing to Italy, and he put us on board. When we had sailed slowly many days and arrived with difficulty off of Cnidus, the wind not permitting us to proceed, we sailed under the shelter of Crete off Salmone. And passing it with difficulty, we came to a place called Fair Havens near the city of Lycia. Now, when much time had been spent and sailing was now dangerous because the fast was already over, Paul advised them, saying, "Men, I perceive that this voyage will end with disaster and much loss, not only of the cargo and ship, but also our lives." Nevertheless, the centurion was more persuaded by the helmsman and the owner of the ship than by the things spoken by Paul. And because the harbor was not suitable to winter in, the majority advised to set sail from there also, if by any means they could reach Phoenix, a harbor of Crete, opening toward the southwest and northwest, and winter there. When the south wind blew softly, supposing that they had obtained their desire, putting out to sea, they sailed close by Crete. But not long after, a tempestuous headwind arose called Euryclidon. So when the ship was caught and could not head into the wind, we let her drive. And running under the shelter of an island called Clauda, we secured the skiff with difficulty. When they had taken it on board, they used cables to undergird the ship, and fearing lest they should run aground on the Syrtis sands, they struck sail and so were driven. And because we were exceedingly tempest-tossed, the next day they lightened the ship, and on the third day we threw the ship's tackle overboard with our own hands. And when neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and no small tempest beat on us, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. But after long abstinences from food, then Paul stood in the midst of them, and he said, "Men, you should have listened to me and not have sailed from Crete and incurred this disaster and loss. And now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. For there stood by me this night an angel of God to whom I belong and whom I serve, saying, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must be brought before Caesar, and indeed God has granted you all those who sail with you. Therefore take heart, men, for I believe God that it will be just as he told me. However, we must run aground on a certain island.' And when the 14th night had come, as we were driven up and down in the Adriatic Sea, about midnight, the sailors sensed that they were drawing near some land. They took soundings and found it to be 20 fathoms. And when they had gone a little farther, they took soundings again and found it to be 15 fathoms. Then, fearing lest we should run aground on the rocks, they dropped 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. And as the sailors were seeking to escape from the ship, when they had let down the skiff into the sea under pretense of putting out anchors from the prow, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, "Unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved." And then the soldiers cut away the ropes of the skiff and let it fall off. And as day was about to dawn, Paul implored them all to take food, saying, "Today is the 14th day. You have waited and continued without food and eaten nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take nourishment, for this is for your survival, since not a hair will fall from the head of any of you." And when he had said these things, he took bread and he gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. Then they were all encouraged and also took food themselves. And in all, we were 276 persons on the ship. And when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship and threw out the wheat into the sea. When it was day, they did not recognize the land, but they observed a bay with a beach under which they planned to run the ship, if possible. And they let go the anchors and left them in the sea, meanwhile loosing the rudder ropes, and they hoisted the mainsail to the wind and made for shore. But striking a place where 2 seas met, they ran the ship aground, and the prow stuck fast and remained immovable. But the stern was being broken up by the violence of the waves. And the soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners, lest any of them should swim away and escape. But the centurion, wanting to save Paul, kept them from their purpose and commanded that those who could swim should jump overboard first and get to land, and the rest, some on boards and some on parts of the ship. And so it was that they all escaped safely to land. Lord, we pray that our hearts would be open to the things that you want to teach us, speak to us, reveal to us from your word by the Holy Spirit. We ask that you would guard our hearts from any distraction that would hinder specifically what we need to hear in terms of navigating through the storms that this life can bring. We ask, Lord, that you would bring us comfort, that you would bring us encouragement, and that you would bring us strength to sustain in whatever place that we find ourselves in this morning. We pray these things confidently and boldly in the name that is above all names, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Very, very exciting chapter. I was blessed this past week to spend a few days in Cannon Beach. They have a special thing for pastors. Every other year you can go and they'll treat you as their guest to stay at the conference center there. And so I took advantage of that and I went by myself to do some writing for the upcoming church membership classes, which thank you for your prayers. I'm very excited about it. It's been very exciting to just write those and to just, as I'm writing things that we'll be sharing with you, to just have it solidified all the more so in my heart, the things that we believe. And every morning I would get up and I would walk along the ocean shores and I would listen to and I would watch the waves coming in. How many of you like to just go to the ocean and watch the waves coming in? It's such a spectacular thing. The ocean is a mighty, powerful, spectacular thing. I love watching the ocean from the shore. I want to emphasize from the shore. And I need to be honest with you that I cannot imagine, as I was reading this and thinking about this, as I was walking on the shore, looking at these waves, knowing that God is in control of the waves, just thinking about every once in a while you see the little, you know, warning tsunami area. You know, that's always encouraging when you're walking on the shore. And at one point, having the imagination that I have, I thought, okay, I wonder how fast I could run if I saw one coming my way. I can't imagine anything more terrifying in this life than facing shipwreck in the middle of the ocean. I get chills even thinking about it, and I know that Myron Sorgenfrey is the same way because he confessed that up there.
And I was going to say, well, you wimp, what's your problem? But I couldn't, because I get freaked out thinking about it as well. I'd just soon watch everybody say, oh, let's go swimming. I'll watch from the shore and watch you. It was hard because on my honeymoon, Jenny and I went to Hawaii and we went snorkeling. And you can't freak out when you're with, so you're snorkeling, you're swimming, acting like you're all that and everything. And I'm just thinking, dear Lord, please keep the sharks away from chewing us up. And yet as I read through our text over and over again, thinking upon the events that were taking place, I could not help but think about the parallel to what we see taking place here in our own lives and this 27th chapter. And what many of us, listen carefully, many of us have either gone through, are going through, or will go through this side of heaven. And it's for this reason that I've entitled this morning's message, Shipwrecked. Because the reality is, sooner or later, we're going to face circumstances in our lives when we will feel at some level that we are shipwrecked and that we are not going to survive. And it's in those times we can take great comfort and instruction from our text, from the Apostle Paul, in what we should do when we face shipwreck. And we can glean a number of things from Paul and how he responded to what appeared to be a hopeless situation. The heart of what we're going to be looking at this morning really doesn't pick up until we get to verse 21. And so rather than go through each of the first 20 verses, I want to just summarize the events that took place prior to verse 21, those verses that we just read. The Bible is very descriptive here of Paul's journey to Rome, which was roughly a 6 to 7 month journey in total, counting the 3 months that he spent on the island of Malta, which we'll look at next week. It was a journey that began in August of 60 AD when Paul and some other prisoners, they were placed in a Roman centurion's care. His name was Julius. And they had planned, it says, to sail along the coast of Asia with Aristarchus, a faithful companion and a friend of Paul's, as well as Luke, the author of the book of Acts, who was accompanying Paul. And because Luke, being a doctor and being very exact in his details, it's easy to chart their course. He was clear to note the details of every part of their journey, where they stopped, what they did, and the like. We read that Julius was kind to Paul, and when they would stop, he would give him liberty to visit friends, to receive care from them. After all, remember, King Agrippa had not found anything. He had declared him to be innocent. There were no formal charges against him. Luke tells us that after changing ships in Myra, a city of Lycia, they, with much difficulty, they came to a place called Fair Havens near the city of Lycia, and they spent enough time there that to continue, based on the time of year, would have been quite dangerous. Paul, having been inspired of the Holy Spirit of such things, but also being a world traveler himself, he warned them of such. He said, "Men, I perceive that this voyage is going to end in disaster and much lives and much loss, the cargo and our lives." But unfortunately, it's just like people who think they know better than the professionals. Isn't that true? There's people like us who think we know better than the pilots of the ship, along with the owner insisting things would be fine, and they convinced Julius to proceed. And I can't help, as we look at that, to think, how often do we ignore what the Lord is telling us to do because we or someone we've sought advice from thinks we know better? How often do we get ourselves in trouble because we think we know better than God? That has happened far too often in my life. And as I think about that, I wonder, how often do we end up shipwrecked simply because we think we have things under control? How many times have we found ourselves shipwrecked because we ignored what we should have been doing and thought, don't worry about it, I got things under control? Of course, this wasn't the case here. Because clearly the Lord was directing the storm that was about to take place. And this is important for us to understand, because we need to remember that the Lord allows, and in some cases, He intentionally directs storms in our lives. Now, why would He do such a thing? He does it to mold us and to shape us into the men and the women that He desires us to be. That is a simple truth about living out our Christian faith. And anybody that's telling you otherwise, they're selling you a bill of goods. It just, biblically, it isn't sound. That there are going to be times, Jesus Himself, He said, in this world you will have shipwreck. Now, He said it this way, in this world you'll have tribulation, you'll have difficulty, but be of good cheer, He said, I've overcome the world. So it's important that we don't let the enemy distract us with the shipwreck and lose sight on the fact of the one who brings us through those difficult situations. Just yesterday morning, we read in our Bible reading, Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 2. Judah shared it with us at the men's breakfast yesterday as well. And here's what we read. And you shall remember, as Moses is giving this second repetition of the law, you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way these 40 years in the wilderness. Why? To humble you and test you, to know what it was in your heart, whether you would keep His commandments or not. See, we need to understand that the Lord will oftentimes intentionally lead us into various storms in our lives to humble us and to test us to know what is in our hearts and whether or not we will remain faithful to His word. Well, we see in our text that in the beginning, things were looking good. They were looking good, right according to their plans. I like those words, the south wind blew softly. The south wind blew softly as they put out to sea. They think, oh man, this is going to be a great, great trip. But before long, it says that a tempestuous headwind arose called a euryclidon, which means winds causing the raising of mighty waves so intense that they couldn't even control the ship. So they had to basically go where the storm was taking them. And this storm, we see, it set in motion a whole lot of attempts to get things under control, just like the storms in our lives. The storms in our lives, they set things in motion, oftentimes our own ideas of what should be done rather than seeking the Lord. It says they use cables to undergird the ship. That's never a very good sign. Well, just in case the ship breaks up, let's undergird the ship with cables. Not a good sign. Then they start throwing things overboard to lighten the ship. Another bad sign. And then after 3 days of this storm, 3 days, they threw the ship's tackle overboard. And then after many days, when no small tempest beat on them, all hope that they would be saved was finally given up. I want you to try to imagine the terror that they were feeling at that time. Have you ever been in a situation where all hope that you would be saved seemed lost? You felt like giving up? When the storms of this life beat on you so fiercely that you feel like you will certainly perish? Maybe some of you are going through that kind of a storm right now. Or maybe just yesterday the wind was softly blowing and now it's starting to kick up. Well, let me assure you this. Not only from our text this morning, but let me assure you from personal experience that when you find yourself in that place, that is when the Lord begins to do His mightiest work in our lives. That is when He begins to do His mightiest work in our lives, just as we see in this situation. If you're taking notes, I want you to note that we're going to be looking at four things demonstrated in the life of Paul and his confidence in the Lord. Four things that we can take to heart and apply to our own lives when we find ourselves shipwrecked. Let's pick up with the first one here in the first couple of few verses, beginning in verse 21. But after long abstinence from food,
things had gotten so intense that they hadn't eaten. Then Paul stood in the midst of them and he said, "Men, you should have listened to me and not sailed from Crete and incurred this disaster and loss. And now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship." I find it interesting that Paul says, "You should have listened to me." Now, there's no hint at all that he's saying, "You should have listened to me, na 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 na." And he's just giving him a bad time. He's just saying, "You know, men, you should have listened to what I was saying." In other words, he's establishing, I knew what I was talking about. And then immediately, verse 22, he encourages them, "I urge you to take heart. Take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship." Now, that'd get me a little bit nervous. Okay, I understand what you're saying, Paul. There is some credibility because obviously you said we shouldn't have gone in the first place, and now we're seeing we shouldn't have gone. But how is it that there's going to be no loss of life among us, but only of the ship? We're not sure how that works. And yet I'm sure that at this point, any encouragement at all would give them a sense of hope. And then two things he says, not two of the four, but two things we must establish before we get to the four. In verse 23, "For there stood it by me this night an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve." I want to point out two very significant things in our text that are key, that are essential if we expect to survive shipwreck when it comes. Two things. There's no sense in even getting to the four things that we see unless we understand these two things. Notice what Paul says. He says here, "An angel of the God, number one, to whom I belong, and number two, to whom I serve." Listen carefully. We cannot expect to even begin to fully embrace the storms of our lives unless we are certain that we belong to God. Amen. We must begin with an understanding that we belong to God, that He purchased us with the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ, and that we belong to Him. First, that we belong to God, and secondly, that we have purposed in our hearts that we are going to serve Him no matter what. And we're reading, we're just finishing up the book of Deuteronomy in our reading through the Bible. In a year, we're in the last of the first five books of the Bible, the Pentateuch, also known as the Torah, the books of Moses. And in Deuteronomy, which we looked at earlier, Moses is reminding the Israelites of how God sustained them over their years of wandering through their wilderness. And Moses reminds them of how their disbelief in the promises of God, their disbelief of who God is, their failure to remember that God was their God and that they were to serve Him, it led to what? It led to their failing to enter into the promised land that first time. Why? Because they focused on the giants in the land. They focused on the crashing waves rather than on the promises that God had given them, the land. When you're going through a storm, it's so easy to focus on the crashing waves instead of the promises of God. And what happened? In the end, of the 12 who went in to spy the land, there was only two, Joshua and Caleb, who genuinely acknowledged, "We belong to God. We will serve Him in the land that He has given us." Are you feeling shipwrecked right now? You belong to God. Are you feeling like the waves are starting to swell up and you're certain they're going to crash over the boat and wash you away and that you're going to drown in the trial that you're going through right now? You belong to God. He saved you. Focus on Him. Serve Him. Even in the midst of the storm, and I assure you, He will bring you through it. I promise you, His Word promises you, He will bring you through it. So Paul assures them, he says, "There stood by me this night an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve," verse 24, saying, "Do not be afraid, Paul, for you must be brought before Caesar, and indeed God has granted you all those who sail with you." As I was reading this chapter in preparation for this study for the first time, I was immediately struck with verse 24, "You must be brought before Caesar." You must be brought before Caesar. Highlight those words. Because Paul here, he would have been remembering that the Lord, what the Lord had previously told him right after he was arrested in Jerusalem. Do you remember chapter 23 of the book of Acts when the Lord stood by him and he said, "Be of good cheer, Paul, for you, as you have testified for me in Jerusalem, you must also bear witness at Rome." And so he's focusing on the fact you must be brought before Caesar. This is a great reminder to Paul that the Lord's going to finish that which he has for him. These men were certain that they were going to perish. Luke writes, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. I remember another storm. You remember we recently read a couple weeks ago in Mark chapter 4 where the disciples, they find themselves in the middle of a terrible storm. They're certain that they're going to perish, forgetting that Jesus said they would get to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and they wake up Jesus, who was fast asleep, obviously not concerned at all. And they wake him up frantic, and they say, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And that's when Jesus, he rose up, and he spoke to the winds and the sea. He said, "Peace, be still." And it said the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And that's when Jesus said, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" And they feared exceedingly, and they said to one another, "Who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him?" All things, including the wind and the sea, they're subject to God. They're subject to the one who created them all. We mustn't forget that. And when we go through the storms of life, we can hold fast to who we know God to be from his promises. When you find yourselves near shipwreck, remember the promises of God. Hold fast to the promises of God and all that we know he can do. You're not going to perish. Even when it feels like you're going to perish, you are not going to perish. Think of Philippians chapter 1. I think of that when I, oh Lord, what's going to happen here? I think of what Paul writes to the church at Philippi. He says, "I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in prayer of mine, making request for you with all joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing." He said, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. He's going to complete the work. And worst case scenario, from our limited perspective, would be you perish. And if you perish, what? Then that obviously was a finished work that the Lord had for you. The only way we don't believe that is if we really don't believe the God of the Bible, who says, it's not about this here. It's about that which is to come. And speaking to people and exhorting people and encouraging people to press on, looking to the hope that will not disappoint us. Verse 25, four things we must do when we find ourselves shipwrecked, back in Acts 27:25. "Therefore, take heart, man, for I believe God that it will be just as it was told me. However, we must run aground on a certain island." Now, the first one is that we must believe God. We must believe God. He says, "Therefore, take heart, men, for I believe God." We must believe God. We must take him at his word. There are countless promises in God's word, things he has said that we can count on whenever we find ourselves in the middle of a violent storm. We can count on these things. I want to go to one of them. Hold your place there and go to Psalm 107, right in the middle of your Bible, Psalm 107. Beginning in verse 4. It's a beautiful psalm, especially when you're going through a difficult time. Look what it says, Psalm 107, verse 4. "They wandered in the wilderness in a desolate way. They found no city to dwell in, hungry and thirsty. Their soul fainted in them. Then," verse 6, They cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them out of their distresses.
Oh.
They cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them out of their distresses. Four times in this psalm do we read, they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them out of their distresses. But it even gets better. Look at verse 28, the very last one. Then they cry out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brings them out of their distresses. I love this. He calms the storm so that its waves are still. And then they are glad because they are quiet. So he guides them to their desired haven. Isn't that beautiful? That's what the Lord does. He calms the storm so that the waves are still. And let me tell you, sometimes everybody else is saying, I don't even know how you survive it. Those waves are crashing in. You must feel like you're about to drown. And people will say, what waves? Because they feel the calming of the storm, the stillness of the waves, not because they're not there, but because he's in the midst of them, guiding them to their desired haven. Some may say, oh, but my desired haven is nowhere in sight. Let me suggest to you, then you should delight yourself in the Lord. Because Psalm 37:3 says, trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the Lord and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. See, as we focus on delighting on the Lord, as we focus on feeding on his faithfulness, he becomes the desire of our hearts, and he guides us to his will, which becomes our desired haven. I hope you're finding, as you get older in the Lord, I hope you're finding that every day he becomes your desired haven. He's the one who gives you rest. He's the one who gives you comfort and strength. As we believe God, he will lead each of us to the desired haven that he has for us. Now go back to verse 27. It says, now when the 14th night had come, I want you to circle that, 14th night had come, as we were driven up and down in the Adriatic Sea, about midnight the sailors sensed that they were drawing near some land. And they took soundings and found it to be 20 fathoms, that's 120 feet. And when they had gone a little farther, they took soundings again and found it to be 15 fathoms, 90 feet. Then fearing lest we should run aground on the rocks, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. And as the sailors were seeking to escape from the ship, when it let down the skiff into the sea under the pretense of putting out anchors from the prow, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. And certainly by now they're listening to Paul. Then the soldiers cut away the ropes of the skiff and let it fall off. And as day was about to dawn, Paul implored them all to take food, saying, today is the 14th day you have waited and continued without food and eaten nothing. Now I was struck as I read these verses with the second thing that we see with Paul, and it's an interesting one. And that is that the storm had been going on for 14 days, for 2 weeks. I don't want it to go on for an hour. I don't want it to go on for 10 minutes, let alone 3 days. And now 14 days, 2 weeks. And all along, Paul is believing God, which brings us to the second thing we must do. Excuse me. And that is wait on God. We're to wait on God. And here's the interesting thing about having to wait on God. Many times you don't have a choice. See, a lot of times, if the Lord said, I want you to just wait for 14 days, then everything's going to be fine. Just fasten your seatbelt and just ride it out. But a lot of times, it doesn't work that way. Most of the times, the Lord says, I want you to wait, not for your timing, but for my timing. A lot of times we don't have a choice but to wait. It isn't easy. We don't like the process of waiting. But here again is where focusing on the promise
of promises of God is so important. Turn with me again. Hold your place. Turn with me again right after Song of Solomon to Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. Verse 31. This is a bit of scripture that we've looked at before. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. How many of us have quoted that or written it on our refrigerators or bought a little plaque that said that? And I read that verse by itself, and I think some people could say, but where's the trial in this verse? You know, okay, I've heard it, we're supposed to wait. But I want you to bump up to verse 28. It was a trial. Look what he says, verse 28. Have you not known? Have you not heard the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, neither faints nor is weary? His understanding is unsearchable. Look at verse 29. He gives power to the weak, to those who have no might. He increases strength. He's addressing those to people who are weak, to people who are shipwrecked, to people who have no might. And he says he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary. And the young men shall utterly fall. Oh, but those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Listen, when we believe God, when we wait on him, as we're going through a trial, he shows himself strong. That's what he told Paul, 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He said, my grace is sufficient for you, for my weakness, my strength is made perfect in your weakness. God's strength is made perfect in our weaknesses. It's good when we're brought to a place where we don't know what to do. It's good when we're brought to a place where we have no more strength in us, because then he can be strong in us. How many of you have experienced that in your life? We know that it's true. We know that it's true. In fact, I had somebody who went through a very difficult trial in their life, and they came up to me and they said, you forgot to say one thing, Pastor Ron. I said, well, what is that? And they said, the value of going through the trial is the next time it comes, you're good to go. Because, you know, Lord, you brought me through that. You can do it again. Once we feel his strength in our weakness, when we feel him showing himself strong, when we're feeling like we can't go on, it prepares us for anything that might come before us. I remember going through a great trial almost 20 years ago. Hard to believe it's been that long. Sometimes it's like it was yesterday. But I remember going through this trial for 2 years, just the unknown part of the trial. And I would cry out to God with everything I had during that time, begging him to resolve it. And that I was forced to wait, not 3 days, not 14 days, not 2 weeks, 2 years, almost 2 years. But I can tell you that in that waiting, in that crying out to God, my faith grew very, very strong. And I met the Lord Jesus in ways that I could not have otherwise. I love what Psalm 27:13 says, I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord, the psalmist writes, David, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Now back to Acts 27, verse 34. And in verse 35, we see the third thing we need to do in the middle of a shipwreck. Verse 34 says, therefore, I urge you to take nourishment, for this is for your survival, since not a hair will fall from the head of any of you. And when Paul had said these things, he took bread and he gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. This is one amazing thing we see here in the Apostle Paul. In the midst of all that is going on, remember the storm at this point, it is still raging. And we see the third thing we need to do when in the middle of a shipwreck, which might be the most difficult of them all, and that is we need to thank God.
We need to thank God. When he had said these things, he took bread and he gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. Can you imagine how powerful that picture must have been to them? We need to thank God. And as I said, it may be the most difficult of all. Oh, you're believing God and you're waiting on God because you don't have a choice. But Pastor, are you kidding me? You mean to tell me I have to have a thankful heart? Well, yes, you do. And I'm convinced scripturally and through personal experience, though it is not easy, that it is a thankful heart that does more to advance the heart of God as most anything. It's a thankful heart. Just being thankful for the things that God has given you. There's so much to be thankful for, and yet the enemy loves to get you distracted and just focus on other things. We're to have thankful hearts before God. Psalm 30, verse 4, sing praise to the Lord, you saints of his, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for life. Weeping may endure for a night or for 14 nights or for over 700 nights. But joy comes in the morning. Amen? Joy comes in the morning. No matter what you're going through, no matter how dismal things may seem, God's joy is around the corner. Morning is coming. Morning is coming. It may take 2 weeks or 2 years or even longer, but God is faithful and his joy will come. Morning is coming. Don't forget that. It's coming. Verse 36, then they were all encouraged and also took food themselves. And in all were 276 persons on the ship. So when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship and they threw out the wheat into the sea. Notice, they threw out the wheat into the sea. Again, the storm still raging. Verse 39, when it was day, they did not recognize the land, but they observed a bay with a beach onto which they planned to run the ship if possible. And check this out, let go the anchors and left them in the sea. Meanwhile, loosing the rudder ropes, and they hoisted the mainsail to the wind, and they made for shore. The fourth thing and the final thing we see in this situation is the need to trust God. Trust God. We're to believe God. We're to wait on God. We're to be thankful to God. And fourthly, we are to trust God. Because again, remember, there's no indication that the storm was letting up. In fact, just the contrary, because as they go into the sand, it says that the waves were breaking up the stern of the boat. But notice it doesn't keep Paul from trusting God, evidenced by throwing out the wheat and letting the anchors go. Imagine the trust it must have taken to do this when going through a shipwreck. It doesn't make sense, but then that's why Proverbs 3:5, the wisest man, Solomon, the wisest man to have ever lived, writes this, trust in the Lord with all your heart and what? And lean not on your own understanding. Don't lean on your own understanding when you're going through difficult times. You see, we tend to default to our own understanding of things when we go through difficulties rather than trust the Lord. We mustn't do that. Our own understanding, listen carefully, our own understanding in those times will always disappoint us. Amen? They'll always disappoint us. Because we can't outthink God. We can't outguess God. Wonder what you're going to do here. Well, I think you should do this. And what happens? We end up disappointed. Why? Because our understanding disappoints. God's understanding never disappoints. Unless we're in disobedience and not wanting to do what he tells us to do. Now, I want to mention this. One of the keys to trusting the Lord during difficulties, don't miss this, one of the keys to trusting the Lord during difficulties is trusting the Lord when things are going well. You may be thinking, well, Pastor, this is a good message. I'm going to keep it in mind for future. I got a couple people that might come in handy for it. Listen, I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but yours is coming around. It's just around the corner. Trust the Lord now. Don't think, well, you know, I'll trust the Lord when I get to it. No, you trust the Lord now. It's one of the keys is trusting the Lord when things are going well, learning to trust the Lord with everything, with every part
of your life. As I visualize this picture of them cutting the anchors loose, the very thing that was designed to keep them from drifting further, I couldn't help but think of what the author of Hebrews wrote in Hebrews 6:19. This hope, that is Jesus, we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which enters the presence behind the veil. When we find ourselves drifting to holding on to other things that give us stability, or that we think give us stability, whether it be our health or money or relationships or job security or any number of things, we need to let those things go. They can be unhealthy anchors. We need to let them go. We need to put our trust in Jesus, letting him be the one who stabilizes us, letting him be the anchor of our souls. And so Paul, believing God, waiting on God, thanking God, and trusting God, it says, verse 41, is striking a place where two seas met, they ran the ship aground. And the prow stuck fast and remained immovable, but the stern was being broken up by the violence of the waves. This clearly was not over. And the soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners, lest any of them should swim away and escape. But the centurion, wanting to save Paul, he kept them from their purpose and commanded that those who could swim should jump overboard first and get to land. And the rest, some on boards and some on parts of the ship. And so it was that they all escaped safely to land. Oh, highlight, and so it was that they all escaped safely to land. That's the most important part. That's the joy in the morning. Listen, how often do we look back over times of shipwreck in our lives and realize we survived? Sometimes we can forget that too quickly. I love looking back at those years and thinking about and realizing I survived. Why did I survive? I survived because God is faithful to finish the work he began in us. And he's going to be faithful to finish the work that he began in each of you. And recognize it. Just because you have a storm, just because you're shipwrecked, it doesn't change that truth about God. Let's get a little preview. Look at verse 16 of chapter 28. Next week, as we conclude the book of Acts, we're going to read 28:16. I love these words. The very first part of verse 16, it says, "Now when we came to Rome." Now when we came to Rome. In other words, they made it to Rome. Because Paul believed God, because Paul waited on God, because Paul thanked God, because Paul trusted God, and he modeled that, he was able to fully come into the plan that God had for him, and so it can be for us. Amen? And so it can be for us. I want to leave you with this quote from G. Campbell Morgan. Look what it says. Of this, he writes this, "All forces seem to combine to make it impossible for this man to reach Rome. And yet this is not the principal impression produced upon the mind as we read the story. It is that of sure, if slow progress, and in the midst of all the storms and tempest and all the difficulties and buffeting and darkness and hopelessness, a man is seen, conducted, cared for, and comforted, until at last his companion writing the story at the close said, so we came to Rome." You see, it is God who cares for us. It is God who conducts our lives, navigates our way through the storm as we're trusting him, as we're waiting upon him, as we're believing in him, as we're thanking him for our circumstances. And how is it that that happens? Because God does it. How was it that Paul got to Rome? God did it. He brought it all about. And he'll do that for our lives as well. Do you believe that? Many of you, I know, you've experienced that. Many of you, I know, are in the midst of the storm right now. And you're seeing land.
and you're able to stand on the promises of God that He's going to get there, you there safely, and not one hair on your head will be lost. I can't tell you how encouraging it is for me to be able to say to somebody who comes to me with a problem that seems absolutely insurmountable to them, to assure them with everything that I have that it's not too big for God. And that God can fix it. And God can get to the other side. The only frustrating part of that process is sometime getting them to believe it. And in that time, all I can do is rely on the Holy Spirit to quicken the hearts to that truth. But I know that it's true, and so many of you know that same thing. God is faithful. God is faithful. First, we must believe that we belong to Him. Then we must be about our lives of serving the one to whom we belong. And then we must believe His promises, believe God for His promises. We must wait on Him. We must thank Him, and we must trust Him. And as we do that, individually and collectively, there isn't anything that He can't and won't bring us through. Amen? Father God, we thank You for these truths in Your Word that transform our lives. We ask, O Lord, that You would, for any of us here, whether we've come through a storm recently, whether we're in the middle of it, whether at the beginning stages of it, whether we're freaking out thinking that we're going to be in it, that You would show us by the Holy Spirit in Your Word that You will carry us through. Lord, help us to believe, to wait, to thank You, and to trust. We love You so much, Lord. We thank You for Your Word that just confirms those things we know to be true. Lord, if You can save us from our wretched selves, Lord, there isn't anything You can't do. Help us to take to heart these things that we read in the Scriptures. Oh, Lord, I can't wait to just hug Paul, thank him for the faithfulness he showed in his life. All because of one reason. Because You saved him. And when he deserved hell, You gave him heaven. When he deserved destruction, You gave him hope. When he lacked purpose, You gave him purpose. Thank You for these truths. Oh Lord, we continue closing our time in an attitude of worship, Lord. Search deep within our hearts the things that You want to speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, if any of you, as we're closing with worship, I'd love to be able to pray with you, and I know I speak for the leadership as well. Maybe you're at soft winds getting a little more intense and you feel a storm coming. We'd love to be able to pray with you and to believe for you that God's with you. Maybe some of you are right in the middle of it and you need prayer. We want to be able to pray with you that God is with you in that. Maybe some of you are outside of the storm. We want to be able to thank God with you. Praise Him with you that He has brought you through that. God is at work. God is moving. And in many respects, brothers and sisters, this is the most important time of our service. We mustn't, as a church, ever lose sight that the minute He says, I'm bringing this to the close, that it's time to zip up our Bibles. No, no, no. That's a time when we lay our hearts before the Lord. And we bring Him our hearts before worship. We humble ourselves before Him. We come for prayer. Oh, we love being able to pray with you. being able to encourage you. So as we sing, just feel free to come forward and let us pray with you, and then Pastor Casey will dismiss you.
Father God, we are yours. As we sung today, Lord, we surrender all. Thank you, Lord God, that you can take us as imperfect people, Lord, and by your Holy Spirit, you can instill life into us. Thank you for your word this day, Father. May our hearts hearts be different. That your word has been implanted, Lord God. Now by your Holy Spirit, bring life to those seeds that were planted, Lord Jesus. Father, bless your church today. Bless our families. We give you this day, Father. We give you this day. Thank you for your blessings. We pray all these things in the mighty and powerful, matchless name of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said amen. If you need prayer,